Excuse me, I'm sorry. Do you know where the Brontosaurus is? Brontosaurus?
No. We are tourists from Holland.
Oh, do you know where the Brontosaurus is?
The Brontosaurus? No, I don't know where he is.
Okay, thank you. I'll ask someone else. Excuse me, have you seen the Brontosaurus?
No.
I think it's there. No.
Oh, okay.
I don't know.
Excuse me, have you seen the Brontosaurus?
No.
Any idea where I should look for it?
Not a clue at this point, trying to find it ourselves.
Well, you won't find a Brontosaurus in this museum because we don't actually have one. But equally, at the moment, you won't find a Brontosaurus labelled as such anywhere in the world. And that's because for many years, the name Brontosaurus has been sunk. Instead, it's been regarded as just another example of a different name, an animal called Apatosaurus. And so the name went out of use until now.
OK, when is a Brontosaurus, that half-elephant, half-giraffe, whip-tailed giant of the Jurassic, not a Brontosaurus? When it's a war baby, a bone war baby. This is the story of a dinosaur child of warring parents, a monstrous reptile we took to our hearts, and whose mistaken identity was collateral damage in a notorious academic feud between fossil frontiersmen of the wild American West. It's a story set in the 1870s, 80s and 90s, when even the word dinosaur was new. It's about the two paleontologist pioneers, Othniel Charles Marsh and Edward Drinker Cope, who gave us the Stegosaurus, Diplodocus, Camarasaurus, Apatosaurus and many other sauruses besides, both real and unreal. Their 30-year bone-prospecting one-upmanship, the Bone Wars, may have turbocharged a golden era of discovery, yet it dragged evolutionary biology very publicly through the mud. For as their teams braved blistering heat and frostbite cold in the rich fossil graveyards of Texas, Colorado and Wyoming, avoiding Indians, living off canned oysters and strawberries in syrup, yuck, or maybe a little fresh elk, chiselling, digging and dynamiting ancient bones into daylight, their masters, Marsh and Cope, acted like a couple of schoolboy cowboys firing cheap shots at each other from behind their comfy professorial desks back east. Theirs was a duel to the finish that destroyed them both in a blaze of tabloid publicity.
New York Herald, January 1890. Scientists wage bitter warfare.
1890 was when it all came tumbling down for Marsh and Cope, when news emerged of the sleazier side of their science. There was the bribery, corruption, spying, and deliberate damage to priceless fossil remains, dynamited so the other guy couldn't study them. The profs even sanctioned real-life shootouts on contested sedimentary rocks. Allegedly. That's what the Bone Wars were all about. They were nasty. Get this. Marsh and Cope were once friends, almost collaborators. They met in Germany, avoiding getting drafted into the American Civil War and enjoying the excitement of a Bavarian discovery some called a missing link, the feathered dinosaur Archaeopteryx. Returning to America, getting down to some dinosaur hunting of their own, Cope invited Marsh on a guided tour of his New Jersey fossil dig. But behind Cope's back, Marsh bribed the quarry owner to send all the best fossil finds to him. And that's how, in 1867, Marsh bagged for himself a creature that should, by rights, have been Cope's.
A new gigantic fossil serpent from the tertiary of New Jersey.
Marsh had fired the opening shot of the Bone Wars, triggering a duel that was to last 30 years. But why? Was it purely in the interests of science, thinking Cope couldn't be trusted with the best fossils? Or was it jealousy? Could the balding Marsh have resented Cope because he was younger, better looking, more charming and richer? Cope had a full head of thick hair, chiselled features, drop-dead moustache and a ready smile for the camera in the days when it was hard to be photographed. Cope looked good. He sang comic songs too, life and soul of the party. Marsh, not so much. Professor Jim Secord is a historian who's written about the tectonic shifts in 19th century science and understands more than most what was going on in the minds of the characters involved. Why does he think the stakes were so high for Marsh and Cope that they stooped so low?
Well, the way I think about it is that This is a period of huge egos in science. For one thing, there isn't a defined scientific career. It's not something you could tell your parents, I want to be a scientist, and they'd go, great. They'd think that was like joining the circus or something like that. And so going into something like science was a surprising thing to do, and it meant that the people who went into it were very often very strong characters.
There were two sets of people involved, weren't there? There was Marsh and Cope, who were the academics making sense of the fossils, and then there were their fossil hunters at the quarry face. Now, the fossil hunters clearly did it for money. They saw that they could sell the bones they found. But what was in it for Marsh and Cope? What sort of an enterprise did they think they were involved in, and why were they so passionate about it?
Well, I think in some ways they had different motives for doing it, which again explains why they disagreed so much. Marsh, who was at Yale University and based there, was really a museum paleontologist. He was trying to get sequences of fossils. He was really trying to build up a detailed specialist understanding of life. He saw himself as the university professional. Edward Drinker Cope, on the other hand, he was also an academic and had academic training, but at the same time, he had a much broader view of what science was for. He wanted to reach out to the public. He wanted to make general theories about evolution on his own. And so for him, the fossils, in some sense, were a means to an end as much as anything else. So because of that, Marsh tended to think that Cope was something of an amateur, and Cope tended to think that Marsh was someone who really wasn't a real gentleman in some ways. Marsh came from a relatively poor family and had a rich uncle who gave him money, but basically he didn't have the kind of social kudos and background that Cope had had.
Now, their rivalry became something of a cause célèbre in the 1890s in the New York Herald, which was a tabloid. The usual fare of the New York Herald might have been more to do with sport and adventure, mightn't it?
Yeah.
Did they see science as a kind of a sport?
Well, I think so. I mean, for one thing, one of the ways that the New York Herald had made its reputation was by sending Henry Stanley out to explore the Congo. And in some ways, the paleontologists were exploring the kind of deep past in the sort of way that Stanley was exploring darkest Africa. That was a huge interest to see that kind of thing could be happening. And so they wanted to bring these things out. And I think people could really identify with and go into that.
Now, thinking about science as an adventure, I came across this diary entry by the geologist Arthur Lakes, who worked for Professor Marsh. And this is him writing out in Wyoming in May 1879.
Whilst resting on the rocks above the railroad, Reed pointed out a little trestle bridge where a party of desperados or road agents had attempted to wreck a passenger train a short time before my arrival, intending to plunge them down an embankment 20 feet deep, which would have been certain death to many, and then rush in and plunder the train in the confusion of the disaster. Fortunately, the rails, which they had displaced for this purpose, were discovered by a train walker in time, and the plot prevented. He showed me a ravine where the desperados camped. The sheriff, named Widowfield, and a deputy, with Western pluck and temerity, undertook to follow up the gang and were both shot and killed from ambush. One of the gang, named Dutch Charlie, was afterwards captured and confessed to the crime. As he was being brought to Carbon to be tried, the miners entered the train, took out the prisoner, hung him to a telegraph pole, and riddled his body with bullets. Such incidents are common enough in this wild, lawless country, which is a paradise for desperados and offscum of civilization.
One of those desperados, it turns out, was Frank James, a brother of the outlaw Jesse James. It was a scary time to be looking for fossils. No walk in the park, was it?
No, absolutely. This was a period, this really is the Wild West. We're talking about a period when, of course, the California Gold Rush had been in the late 1840s and onwards, and there were continual series of, after that, movements to fill in the rest of the United States between California and the eastern states. And this at the time that these people are going there, there's all sorts of things going on. For one thing, you have real outlaws there. You have attempts to deal with what was thought to be the Indian problem, the Native Americans who were being displaced, and how to put them on reservations and where they should be. And people had very different kinds of reactions to that, both white people and Native Americans, about how this should be handled. And so hunting for fossils wasn't just going into a blank slate or a quarry and picking out what you wanted to see and hunting for that. It was something that needed to be, it was part of the opening up of the West in some ways. And I think it's part of the great age of empire. It's the time when the British Empire is really expanding and becoming much more centrally controlled. And the same kind of idea that you need to control this.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.